Hello, everyone. This is Jim Young, your host for Be Here Now. Namaste. I honor your dignity. I honor your divinity. All is one. Indeed, we are. Thank you for being here with me this morning. I thought in this beautiful month of May, when everything is blooming so profusely by this stage of the game, that we might talk about beauty from a variety of perspectives, some of my own as well as others that have been come into my sense of discernment here. I hope you'll enjoy these today. I hope you'll drink them in your heart of hearts and see how very much like a kaleidoscope where you look in it and see a beautiful sort of landscape of glass, colored glass, sparkling brightly. And you turn it just a bit of a turn and you see yet another sense of beauty. Well, that's the way I'd like you to think about this today, just various aspects of beauty. And I'm sure you have your own ideas about it. So let's start with this. Recently received from a friend a thought about this, written by Ralph Waldo Emerson, a beautiful piece, actually. At least that's my view of it. It's beautiful. We live in succession, in division, in parts, in particles. Meantime, within man is the soul of the whole, the wise silence, the universal beauty to which every part and particle is equally related, the eternal one. And this deep power in which we exist and whose beatitude is all accessible to us is not only self-sufficing and perfect in every hour, but the act of seeing and the thing seen, the seer and the spectacle, the subject and the object are one. We see the world piece by piece as the sun, the moon, the animal, the tree, but whole, of which these are shining parts, is the soul. And that, by Emerson, is beauty. I have another piece here, Labor Beauty. It was written by David White. A beautiful piece called Beauty, simply. And it is simply beautiful. Beauty is the harvest of presence, the evanescent moment of seeing or hearing on the outside what already lives far inside us. The eyes, the ears, or the imagination suddenly become a bridge between the here and the there. Between then and now, between the inside and the outside. Beauty is the conversation between what we think is happening outside in the world and what is just about to occur far inside. Beauty is an achieved state of both deep attention and self-forgetting. The self-forgetting of seeing, hearing, smelling, or touching that erases our separation, our distance, our fear of the other. Beauty invites us through entrancement of that fearful frontier between what we think makes us and what we think makes the world. Beauty is almost always found in symmetries and intriguing asymmetries. The symmetries and asymmetries seen out in creation, the wings of the moth, the airy sky and the solid earth, the restful, focused eyes of a loving face in which we see our own self reflected. The symmetry also, therefore, of bringing together inner and outer recognitions, the far horizon of otherness seen in that face joined to the deep inner horizon of our own being. Beauty is an inner and an outer complexion living in one face. Beauty especially occurs in the meeting of time with the timeless, the passing moment framed by what has happened and what is about to occur, the scattering of the first spring apple blossom, the turning, spiraling flight of a curled leaf in the falling light, the smoothing of white, sun-filled sheets by careful hands, setting them to air on a line, the broad expanse of cotton filled by the breeze only for a moment, the sheets sailing on into dryness, billowing toward a future that is always beckoning, always just behind us. Beauty is the harvest of presence. Oh, is it ever? A few from little snippets from one of my writings on beauty. Each of us is nature's beauty uniquely individualized. I'm not talking about beauty that is only skin deep. Real beauty glows from the inside out. In truth alone does beauty reign, not in some facade layered by belief onto matter. Of this we can be sure. Inward, we already have all we need to actively and authentically participate in this new way of life. We only need to shift our material perspective to spiritual knowing in our heart of hearts. much like turning a kaleidoscope ever so gently in order to obtain yet another form of beauty. Preceding the need to speak out in truth, thus demonstrating the beauty of truth, cosmic or Christ consciousness informs us as truth, as beauty. Much like an acorn taking years to mature into a powerful oak tree, truth and beauty, like the essence of true love, is more than a thousand kisses deep, emitting the glow only soul can impart, demonstrating soul as only soul can. Truthfully, beauty abounds. And lastly, living true to ourselves is the most elegant and most honest gift we can give to the universe. This is because the truth is unadorned with erroneous beliefs and opinions. Truth is absolute beauty and love, and I hope we live it thus. And I'll conclude now with just a little saying, but I hope it's one you'll take to heart, because I think we put ourselves in a prison of belief and opinion about ourselves that is not at all truth. It's way too small, not nearly expansive enough to include what it is we really are. This is from Benedictine nun Macrina Whitaker. Years ago, she wrote this, and I saved it in my notes as something I really treasure. And this is her prayer for us, today and always. Oh God, help me believe the truth about myself, no matter how beautiful it is. And there you have it. Well, beautiful ones, I hope you have a wonderful week. We'll see you here next week, same time, same place, I hope. Know this, I love you. Namaste.
Did you know Lions Clubs International is the largest service club organization in the world? Its 1.35 million members in more than 46,000 clubs are serving communities in 207 countries and geographical areas around the globe. Since 1917, Lions Clubs have aided the blind and visually impaired, championed youth initiatives, and strengthened local communities through hands-on service and humanitarian projects. The Lions' motto is, We Serve. And local Lions Club programs include sight conservation, hearing and speech conservation, diabetes awareness, youth outreach, international relations, environmental issues, and many other programs. The Lions Club of Eureka Springs is seeking civic-minded men and women to join them in making a difference in our community, and we would love to have you join us in our work. The club meets the second and fourth Wednesday of every month at Forest Hill Restaurant at noon. Please join us for lunch. We'll be so glad to see you.
We like poets and poetry here on Ozark Radio, and it was our pleasure to visit the Village Writing School in Eureka Springs, Arkansas, recently to record some of the writers who are working there. We're going to feature these writers as we go through the summer months. Today, we're going to hear from poet Reba Armstrong.
Hi, my name is Reba Armstrong. I'm going to read some poems to you today, and the first one is called Softly, Softly, and it was inspired by nature, an aspect of nature, and this area, of course, is so abundant with that. And so I'm going to read Softly, Softly to you. Trees silently shudder. Branches sway in an enticing dance. Leaves rustle in excitement. And a woman's heart beats to the rhythm of the forest. You cool her brow on a summer's day, and her heart awakens with your soft stroke. Her eyelids yield to dreamless slumber as you gently play across her cheek. Fawns of the forest frolic. Ants pause in their labor. Birds' feathers rustle in your tickling presence. Wolves halt the hunt. Fern fronds sway in sync with the rhythm of your tickle and tease. Petulant petals smile at your delicate touch. Grasses bend at your every whim. One minute, I feel your comforting caress, yet in the subsequent moment, you have vanished, diminishing as quickly as you have materialized, and a yearning grows for your speedy return. Where do you go? Over vast turbulent seas, across craggy mountains that kiss the sky, over sweltering deserts where lizards play? How may I find you? Can I conjure you? Can I dream you? Will you ever comfort again? Breeze gently whispers, "No, precious mortal, that I shall return again and again, softly, softly." The second one is called Little Boy in a Hotel Lobby. It's a narrative, and it was inspired by a real life event. Little Boy in a Hotel Lobby. Evening. Quiet. A family sans father enters. Sweet little boy, wide pure eyes, curious open. Mom, sweet face, gentle, self-effacing. Adolescent daughter, hard face, steely, guarded. Boy, I like your earrings. Thank you, I like your SpongeBob t-shirt. Boy, here, this is for you. Thank you, as he hands me a tiny purple flower. Your little boy has a good heart. Boy, my mom and dad fight. Remember, Mom? You had a bloody nose. Mom smiles a sad, embarrassed smile. Sister grimaces as her expression hardens. The little boy tugs on his mother's sleeve, pleading. Remember, 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 remember? I think, of course she remembers. She needs no reminder. This family time at the hotel was meant to be fun, carefree, playful, adventurous, relaxing. But now the specter of her husband looms. The light goes out on her sweet face. I quietly clear my throat and excuse myself. The final one I'm going to read to you is entitled Ode to a Can Opener. It is inspired by a gift my youngest sister gave me. Because it's from her, it's very precious. Ode to a Can Opener. Oh, lovely can opener. May I call you Can? You entered my bereft existence without a fanfare to welcome you. With no further ado, you arrived in a simple brown bag with an embedded good cook tag. Upon viewing your elegant single grip, I thought, Can, you are quite a pip. After minutes of inspection and admiration, I noted there was no stipulation as to how to activate you, so I circled around to get a better view. One handle, a diminutive stainless wheel, on your left side, a kind of keel, a silver rod rounded in half-moon fashion, a gateway arch that sated my design passion, a Mickey Mouse-eared handle on the right. How was I going to open a can without a fight? For I had no clue as to what to do. No instructions were calling out, Yoo-hoo! I knew not where to turn. Where do I go to learn? Ah, with my own wit, I can do this song kit. So I grasped the handlebar of the opener with a guttural har-har. I gingerly fit it over the lid of the kitty food can, yes I did, and commenced to clockwising Mickey Mouse, and lo and behold, the can moved clockwise. When Can arrived at Journey's End, her lid lifted off, no finger to mend. For the side of the container was cut clean, no opportunity for the can to get mean. Cuts with this can opener will never materialize, for the ingenious way it slices the tin sidewise. So, if you are seeking the perfect gift and want to give someone a lift, give them a good cook can opener. It will never, ever forsake her.
Many thanks to the Village Writing School of Eureka Springs, Arkansas, for letting us come and visit them. Next week, another poet or essayist.